Welcome. This is Gaia Rising Now, where we'll explore the origins of humanity and what it means to be human in the 21st century. I'm Wendy Morrison-Merritt, and this is the puppet poet, Keith Merritt. You'll meet many artists and activists who, in their own right, work hard to get the message of humanity out each and every day. Now let's head over to Audi's Olympic in the Tower District of Fresno to meet some of our Central Valley activists. United together, we are Gaia Rising Now. Hey everyone, thanks for showing up. Gary, you there? Gary?
I'm Gary Baxter in Fresno, California. Good morning, Wendy. Hope you're well. I'm here to speak about problems going on in our country, in our state, and in our city, and overall the entire world. These are problems arising from government control and policy. I don't know if the elites in Britain are involved with this. It's very possible. I'm sure it stems way back to the king and queen at some point. I am here in the Fresno Tower District in back of Audi's Olympic, and we are going to introduce you to our new show. I would like to thank the people that are going to talk with us today. I am opposed to geoengineering, to GMOs in our food. I'm opposed to vaccines. I am opposed to police brutality. And I believe these things are entwined. They all connect. If you connect the dots, you'll see the one big demon that we are all living under. This oppression that is crawling up our spine like a cancer. There's so much inadequacy on our planet right now. And if anything, we should be growing as a people and as humans, as a race, as brothers and sisters. We shouldn't still be at war. We shouldn't have poor people in the streets, hungry children everywhere. I'm not happy with the current affair of our planet right now. I am also not afraid. I'm willing to stand up and say these things, and like many of my friends know, we take a lot of heat for it. A lot of people don't understand it yet. A lot of people are still waking up and trying to wake up. Some of them are not going to. We have to persist on and on. I'm a local musician. I play in a band called Llama Boy. I have our second album coming out. It'll be this spring in 2015. It's called Llama Boy in the Nation of Sheep. Many of the songs on this record are going to talk about revolution, about catching your frequency vibration. Show. Thanks again. Wendy Morrison, you rock.
Hi, everyone. I'm Pam Nicolte. I'm here in Fresno, California, to come out here and talk to you about my activism here locally in the Valley. I'm a single mom, and I've been persecuted by the system my whole life. And it didn't make any sense till about 5 years ago. It started to make some sense when I noticed these white lines up in the sky that didn't make any sense to me. And then I started to get really, really sick. And I just started to research what the heck was going on up there. It just didn't make any sense to me why planes would fly overhead and leave contrails that stayed all day. 56 years old, I grew up with airplanes in the sky. I know a contrail. They stay for a couple seconds and then they dissipate. But what I've been watching is lines going left, right, in circles, grid patterns, X's, O's. Shyest smiley faces, and then I've watched it over the course of the day spread and cover our sky so that our blue sky that I remember as a child is now a grayish blue gray. And I'm watching everybody around me get sick, including myself. And so I decided a long time ago that I was going to keep researching this and start asking people what was going on. And as I asked people what they thought it was, they kept telling me it was contrails, which made me dig even further. So don't call me a conspiracy theorist. What I am is a realist. Our planet is under attack. I'm 100% positive of this, and I'm not going to back down. I'm not going to shy away. I'm going to continue to reach out and trying to bring this to reality for humanity as a whole. My thought on this is that we're being poisoned. I'm not sure who's doing it, and I'm not sure why it's being done, but I think it goes to the global elites who sit in rooms, smoke big cigars, stuff their faces, and laugh while they kill us. And I believe that they're trying to kill us. Why are they trying to kill us? Well, I think that they don't like the fact that we don't follow their rules. I personally will not get a driver's license anymore. I'm not going to pay any taxes anymore. Yeah, I'm going to say it publicly. I don't get vaccines. I don't eat genetically modified foods. And I'm beginning to think I need to wear a gas mask on a daily basis. But some really strange things have come to light with this geoengineering. One is now there's fibers falling from the sky. The second thing is there's these plastic polymers in the snow. The snow don't melt. It looks like cobwebs everywhere after they spray or there's a snow. In people who are looking at the research on these, you know, trying to test what's going on, is finding that in the fibers that they wiggle. I don't know if you know anything about Morgollon's disease, but it's some sort of strange disease that can't be identified as an earthly object. So I think that they're trying, and I know this is going to sound really crazy, but I think they're trying to transform us, transform our DNA into a different type of entity. That's all I can say. Now, are the people who are doing this a different entity? You know, I mean, I hear speculation that they're even aliens, and that very well could be. I don't know. But all I know is I think that they're trying to change us. And that took me to a topic called transhumanism, where they're trying to combine humans with robots. And that's what I think they're dropping these fibers on us. But I do believe that we are under attack worldwide, and that's why I have closed my business. I'm working aggressively to get my health back, and I've partnered up with a couple key people here in Fresno. Sam Chaney, who's with We Are Change Fresno TV, and Stuart Webb with We Are Change Fresno TV. I've stood behind them. I've stood behind them in the shadows, but I'm putting my face out there now. Look, everybody, I don't care how much money you have, or how nice your home is, or what kind of damn sports car you're driving. If we don't stop them spraying us, we don't need to do police activism. We don't need to worry about genetically modified foods. We don't need to worry about the mercury in the vaccines. We don't need to worry about anything. It's a slow death. In my research, I found an old prophecy from the Hopi Indians. I'm half Omaha, I'm half Sioux. This prophecy is really powerful to me, and I want you guys to think about this. It says in the end times that the skies will be covered in cobwebs. And all I see right now as I stand here is cobwebs and planes. And I don't know who's flying them, and I'm not sure exactly what's in it. But I can assure you that we are under attack, and everybody needs to get involved. This is a worldwide humanity thing. And if you don't get involved, you're just going to die a slow death. I said this at an air quality control board meeting recently. Look around. Do you know anybody who is not sick? I don't. So peace, love, and liberty. Thank you for listening to me. I'm really a nobody. I'm just a grandma. And please get involved. And last, before I let you go, weaponizednews.com. Go there. That's where you're going to find out really what's going on. We're not going to lie to you ever. And an arm of that is Geoengineering Action Network. Go there. Take some action. Stop pushing buttons on your damn keyboards and talking to Facebook people who already know what's going on. We got to get the message out. Small business cards. Weaponized News, we are producing radio commercials that can be aired on any radio station across the entire planet. We're here to help you figure out how to get them on the radio stations. We've got pre-designed billboards, so you can get billboards up in your area. But whatever you do, take action, because without air, there's no life. Peace.
Hey everybody, I'm Brian Sumner. I'm a local police accountability activist in Fresno, California. And I'm just here to talk to you real briefly about the importance of holding the police accountability in your community and organizing community watchdog groups that vigilantly and publicly hold the police accountable for their actions. That starts with a camera. Now everyone has a smartphone in their pocket these days, and so you can very quickly pull that out of your pocket to film any police interaction involving you or another. Another thing is find like-minded individuals in your community and organize on a weekly, monthly, bi-monthly basis in order to address community problems that you may have. For those of you that don't know, an African-American man is killed by the police every 28 minutes in this country. The police have killed over 1,000 people in 2014, equaling to over 3 killings a day nationwide. If we don't address this epidemic, and we don't address this epidemic now, eventually the police will become, well, they already have become, the police have become a larger threat to our liberty than any foreign terrorist in any country that our nation is currently at war with. Check me out at the Fresno Liberty Movement on Facebook and at briandavidsumner.com on the internet.
Hello friends, this is Sam Chaney reporting to you for weaponizednews.com. Today is January 8th, 2015. We're speaking out and taking action in Fresno to raise the public awareness and consciousness level to the threat of the global government that they're fastly forming in front of us. Your government, the U.S. government, city, county, state, national, they don't represent your interest. They represent their own self-best interest. I can tell you this from experience. The only way that things are going to change in this country is we have to hold these people accountable. They act like we work for them, the taxpayers. I'm a taxpayer. I pay for them to operate. Okay, so let's get that straight. We need to hold those people in the government accountable. But the cops on the street are not setting policy. Okay, they're not passing laws. They're following the laws that the corrupt politicians and bureaucrats are passing. And so we need to hold these people accountable and continue to call them out. The only way things are going to get any better in this country is if we get the special interest out of politics and get people interested in politics, because most people don't really care at this point. They're happy with their television show, with their iPad, with their computer, with their Facebook, with their cell phone. There's so many distractions now that it's easy to bury your head in the sand and not care about much. But like Pam said before, they're spraying us. They are geoengineering the planet. Okay, it's on record. There's thousands of scientific documents. All you got to do is search the ethics of geoengineering. It is undeniable. They openly talk about it. The geoengineering scientists do. Okay, that is probably the number one concern, but they are engineering everything. Everything has been weaponized against you. That's why I'm producing weaponizednews.com. We have a television show that runs here on local access television daily. We have a weekly radio broadcast on 1680 AM, Saturday nights, 6 to 8 o'clock. Tune in. If you're out of the local radio area, tune in to My 1680 on Saturday nights from 6 to 8 p.m. We will tell you the alternative view that differs from the mainstream narrative that the media is selling you in this country. We've been lied to on a massive scale. You've been lied to your whole life by the education system, probably by your own family, because they've been lied to. They don't know any better, okay? All it takes is reading some books, and you will see that it's all written, all right? And so I don't want to hear any nonsense about from ignorant people. Read some books. The people behind this are the private central banks. They are the ones financing all these illegal operations, the spraying in the sky, to the genetically modified food, to the fluoride and chlorine in your water. All right? None of this would be happening in this country if we had a sound monetary system. That is where the rubber meets the road, and that is what is going to collapse this country and the rest of the world so they can bring in their one world government, one world currency. I advise you to go look at some history and go back to 1913. That's when the private Federal Reserve was established in this country. And since then, they have done nothing but print debt. That's how money's created. I suggest you look it up. They sell treasury bonds, which is debt. And then our government, using taxpayer money, buys them back from private central bank at interest. That is how our monetary system works. It's debt-based. It's designed to enslave us through debt. Every country that is under this debt-based monetary system, central bank cartel, which is Europe, which is America, which is Japan, all major Western powers are underneath this central banking cartel. Now, until we get sound money and overthrow this central banking cartel, things will never be right in this world, because the controllers of the central bank can just make an entry on a computer screen on their books, in their general ledger, and create money out of nothing. Understand that. It is magic. It is occult magic that they're using against us. The global elite are dark occultists, Satan worshipers. That is what we are up against. So all it takes for evil to triumph in this world is for good people to do nothing. I advise that you stand up for yourself and your family's future if you care about anything in this world, and look into what I'm saying, and it all leads back to the central banks, the poisoning of you and your family, and your horrible death can be led back to the global elite central bankers. Go to weaponizednews.com, because like I said, everything has been weaponized against you and your family to destroy you and your mind.
January 2015. Happy New Year.
Woohoo! Guy's going to give us our first Gaia report. Go for it. What's happening?
So the state of the planet here in early January 2015 is not good and getting worse, largely as a result of industrial civilization. We continue to drive to extinction more than 150 species every single day. That's genocide. We continue to dirty the air and foul the water, erode our soils into the ocean, and wonder why it isn't the same planet we grew up on. For those of us who are of a certain age, we'll say, it's a very different planet than the one we grew up on. We have a lot more toys. We have a lot more capability to conduct exercises like this one, for example, which is amazing in and of itself. But there's a price to be paid. You can't have infinite growth on a finite planet without consequences. And we've been suffering the consequences. And in particular, the living planet has been suffering the consequences. That's going to come back. It's going to come back around, because it always does. It's going to bite us where we least expect it.
Yeah, it already has. Well, do you think that there's any one area that we can focus on as individuals in this coming year that will make a difference?
Well, yes. I think that we can focus on going to that certain place that we all have, that certain place inside of us, and be introspective about our place in the universe. What does it mean to be human at this time in history? What does it mean to be me? To be an individual, sentient human being on a speck, on a speck, on a speck in the midst of the most massive multiverse, a universe within universes. What does that mean? And where do I go? What do I become in light of the information that I'm a sentient being on a speck, on a speck, on a speck, going through space at an incredible rate of speed and interacting with these other human beings? What does that mean? Am I a corporate drone? Do I serve the masters who are pulling the levers of industry? Or do I discover what I am at my core and what it means to be me?
Very well said. Very well said. Yeah, what it means to be human. What it means to be human on this beautiful planet, Gaia. And I thank you for that. That was very well encapsulated. And we hope that people continue to be inspired by your work and by your words and by the unity and the unification of people that care. People that care.
Well, I hope people continue to be inspired because I continue to be inspired by people who are acting humanely as humans are capable of doing. And that's an inspiration for me. People who take seriously the notions of kindness and compassion and pursuing what it means to be human at this most amazing, most marvelous time in history, and taking care of their inner psyche while trying to do something good on this planet for the limited time we have in this place. That's inspiring. How could you not be inspired by that? How could you not be liberated beyond the ties of culture to find your place and to do the things that are within you? So what other people are doing is what inspires me. I can only hope that I can continue to serve people on the rest of the living planet.
Thank you, Guy. Have a wonderful year, and we'll check in with you from time to time. All right, thank you.
Yes, that would be awesome. Oh, that would be awesome. Thank you, Wendy.
All right, sweetheart. Talk to you soon. Thank you. homie Misty. Hey, baby, how's it going? You look pretty there.
Hey, Wynn, I miss you.
I miss you too,
baby. I'm super excited that this is all coming together.
I know. And, it's really great.
I'm so thankful. Yeah, I'm so thankful to be part of this show that, you know, it's created by artists and activists and people who give a damn, you know?
Yeah, so Misty's going to be giving us our L.A. Information, shall we say, things that are going on in L.A., and I just wanted you guys to meet her. So she's going to tell you a little bit about, you know, what she's thinking and how she's feeling, and we'll talk a little bit more. Go ahead, Misty.
Hey everyone, I'm Misty Tamborelli. I am a live streaming producer at Absolute Live Productions based in Burbank. And, you know, I've been doing that for about 10 years. Above all, I'm a mother. And, I really care about the children and the state of our planet. And I'm, again, very happy to be a part of this. And I've known Wendy. She's been like a mentor to me. And she just has every good intention in her heart to really, you know, improve this place and weed out the misinformation and the lies that we've all been given. And it's really an honor to be a part of this. Thank you, Wendy.
Well, I am honored to have you on the crew, and I think the crew itself, the show, is the more enriched for your participation. Misty is a beautiful, beautiful spirit, and as she said, I've known her since she was just a babe, and I've been on this path for a really, 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 really long time. I never went to sleep, so I've been awake and painfully forging forward alone for decade after decade. And Misty came along in my life path a few decades back, and she's just the most giving person. And we will look forward to her reports, because they'll be a potpourri of Misty. So tell me, I know we talked a little bit about some of the things that you wanted to bring to the table to share with people. Why don't you run through some of the things that you were telling me?
Great. You know, I have a lot of questions, and I want to hear some opinions. I want to hear, you know, different sides, so I can kind of take and choose what to piece together. I just kind of, you know, want to hear more things that kind of relieve stress. There's a slew of things that I do. I know that you're an expert at that.
I'm not an expert at everything, but I am an expert at being a pain in the ass, though. That is absolutely,
no,
I own it. but yeah, you know, there's things that all humans need to know about being human right now on this earth, because we are, as our other activists from Central Valley were, you know, sharing with us, we are being bombarded with an exorbitant amount of low frequency waves. Our smart meters in every house, digital TVs, televisions in every house, your cell phone. Add to that, you know, GMOs in the food and fluoride in the water and you know, in your body, and between the chemicals and the frequencies, and then Mother Earth herself is going through her own evolution, and in doing so is shifting from carbon 12 to carbon 7. And so we are going to be evolving with her. And with that comes just being able to carry that higher frequency. We need to change the way we live our lives. And that includes things that impact us both physically, but mentally and spiritually and creatively. We are co-creators here on this planet. So if our minds are engaged and trapped in fear, We are not progressing the planet. We are not bringing anything to the table except the destruction of humanity. Because to save ourselves, we have to save ourselves. We have to, you know, as you were sharing, you know, your thoughts about, tell me about the dance therapy. I think dance is one of the most important things that we can do to distress.
Right. For me, I'm a self-proclaimed dancer. It's been my meditation and my remedy. It's always what I draw back to. Just finding a mirror, you know, taking 5 minutes a day, just letting it all loose, finding, you know, some really good music at the right frequencies, and just kind of forgetting everything and just getting in tune with, you know, letting my body embrace that music and letting whatever comes out and whichever way I move, you know. Yeah. And when I'm done, I'm ready, you know. I have fresh air. I'm a little bit, you know, loosened up, my body.
Well, here's
done a little research, and you know, it's an ancient technique, you know.
Absolutely. Well, what it is, I'm so glad you brought this up specifically too, because a lot of times people, as they're awakening, if you mention meditation to them, it's like, oh. But you don't have to sit down still and quiet to meditate. When I was taught transcendental meditation at 9 years old in Hawaii, my teachers, it wasn't about sitting and meditating, because they recognized that children couldn't sit still, you know? So the way they taught us our meditation was when we were active and moving. So it would be like when I walked to school, you know, I would go into my mind and, you know what I mean? And connect in the same way as if I was sitting, you know, and meditating alone in a room. So, dance is another expression of meditation in my eyes, and I think many people feel that intuitively. They don't even realize, they just love to dance, you know. They just love to just let loose and dance, and they don't realize that that's their own spirit showing them how to recharge and rejuvenate. So that'll be great. And I know we both share a love for crystals, and that kind of ties in with the frequencies again, you know, just how to mitigate a lot of the frequencies, not only, you know, the ones that are out there supposedly to help us, you know, technology, but also the ones that are purposely put out there to scramble our brains and to keep us in a state of distress. Again, tying in with your dance therapy, you know, you're being targeted each and every day to stay in a low frequency, negative, you know, fear-based struggle for survival. So any sliver and slice of life, of light, of joy, of being, you know, crystals, gardening, you know, you're sitting there in front of that beautiful tree. It looks like an orange tree, but I know you said it was a kumquat, right?
Yep, fresh off the tree. Just whoop, grab whoop, one, whoop, pop it in your mouth. They're a little tangy still right now.
I gotta send some goat poop up to you so you can fertilize. Thanks. I gotta send some goat poop up to you so you can fertilize it. you know.
That was post pile, and out sprung 5 little bell peppers.
Wow. It doesn't take much.
Like, it was so cool. I was like, really?
Well, it just shows you how beautiful Mother Nature is, and she's just waiting to provide us with sustenance and you know, the nectar of her life force, if even from poop. Especially from poop.
So good.
Well, you're a nectar, my little goddess. Well, anyway, hey, you're going to report next month at the Conscious Life Expo for us. I guess mm-hmm. Absolute Productions is going to be doing the live streaming there. And you guys, what's your station? Is Streaming for the Soul? What's that?
We have a platform called streamingforthesoul.tv.
Okay.
Where we feature, you know, different speakers, healers, a lot of information there.
So the
we're very excited about the Conscious Life Expo this year. It'll be our third year in a row.
Awesome.
Yeah, looking forward to meeting some great people and, you know, letting them know about Gaia Rising Now. Very excited about that.
Well, it's February 6th through the 8th at the LAX Hilton. And again, it's the Conscious Life Expo. And my friend in my heart, Laura Eisenhower is going to be there. And Dr. Guy's friend, Tom Hartman, is going to also be one of the guests there, just to name a few. And I went through the whole website. It looks like it's going to be a really great presentation this year. As we're getting closer and closer to, you know, the nuts and bolts of possibly real disclosure soon. God help us, please. I want disclosure. But anyway, well, we'll be looking forward to that. You're going to be just roaming around with the crew and getting some footage and talking to some cool people and showing everybody what's going on there.
Huh? Yeah, and again, love to try to pull you out of the forest and get you there, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Well, there.
That might happen. That might happen.
We'll see.
Someday.
Get you out of there.
That might happen someday. Well, it took me so long to get out of Los Angeles. You know, it's like you're going to have to put a...
baby.
You'd have to put a collar on me to get me back. Come on, little doggy. Me and John Lennon, I'm going to be there with a white rabbit on Hollywood Boulevard going, and if you go chasing rabbits, you'll end up down a hole.
Alice?
What's that?
Can I call you Alice?
I don't know. Just call me Orange Ray. Anyway, honey, you look gorgeous. I love you so much. I want to pinch your cheeks and give you a big hug. And
I love to John and the rest of the farm, and of course Pixie and Keith. And
woo, there's
you
the
guys
plane.
Are amazing.
The plane.
I'm very struck, like always.
It's crazy. I don't miss that.
I love you so much, and thanks for checking in with me. I look forward to seeing the show launch.
Thank you so much for being here, and we will look forward to your report next month, okay?
There you go.
Yeah, and that's it. I love you. Look at how gorgeous
you
are. All right, honey.
Stop.
All right, I'll talk to you soon, babe. Love you.
Okay, love you too. Bye.
Bye-bye, honey. I want you to tell us your stories. You've got some great stories. I know you do. They are awesome because I've heard some of them and they are hilarious. And they really encapsulate some of the joyfulness that I know you garner from your experiences, you know, traveling around. I mean, that's got to be really intense to do that. I can't say that I would enjoy it. And the anxiety of, like, what are you going to find on the other end? Oh, my Lord. And then, of course, it unfolds. Whatever it is, wherever you're at, once you get there, it unfolds. The story.
Yeah. And, you know, I do meet the most interesting people when I go on the road, and in general my hosts and hostesses like yourself are a little bit beyond the mainstream, where they wouldn't be hosting somebody like me. And so I meet these incredible people, and they treat me incredibly well. And they further reinforce for me throwing off the shackles of the mainstream culture. And so, and a major pivotal step in this direction occurred in Hollywood, I guess it was about a year and a half ago. And I was hosted by a voiceover actress, and she's part of a time bank. She didn't have time to pick me up at the airport. She was working, so she had somebody else in the time bank pick me up at the airport. So Zach picked me up, and we drove the 4 or 5 miles from the airport to Hollywood, and it only took about 2.5 hours. Gotta love that LA traffic. And we get to the house, and Zach and the hostess hadn't met each other before, and so we all chatted for a little bit. We were there for about 5 minutes, and Catherine says, "So, look for something to wear. We're going to a party tonight." And Zach and I look at each other, and we're like, I think we look fine, actually, in what we have on now. She said, no, it's a no-clothes party. Oh, welcome to Hollywood. So I wore a bamboo beach mat held up with a bicycle inner tube with a paint roller for a sheath for my wine bottle and a bicycle seat cover for my beret.
I want the picture that goes with this. I do. I really have to have it. It's like I have to have the picture that goes with this.
I will send you the picture because there actually is one.
I know. Well, I think you sent it to me once and I couldn't find it. I've looked everywhere. You're in a toga or something, right?
I'm in a bamboo beach mat.
Oh, God.
I have this bamboo beach mat wrapped around me. I look completely absurd.
Oh, God.
I actually used the picture the following day in a presentation. So the bicycle connection here is that the party was held at a bicycle cooperative, one of the big bicycle cooperatives in Los Angeles. And so everybody there was wearing non-clothing. You know, all their private parts were appropriately covered.
Oh my God.
There was a lot of sharing of herb and alcohol.
Yeah.
And people wearing most unusual things. The next day, I delivered a presentation at a different bicycle cooperative, and I showed that picture. You know, in this day of amazing technology, the picture was available immediately, and so I was able to show that picture as an example of how I'm throwing off the shackles of culture. That's one of my responses to this information I present, is that I show up at a place, I've met somebody, and 5 minutes later I agree to go to a no-clothes party. the following night after the presentation, I stayed at a third bicycle cooperative in Los Angeles, and I slept on a couch that night that I'm pretty sure harbored 30 or 40 sexually transmitted diseases. It was pretty interesting place. And that, too, is where my travels take me. I never am really sure what couch I'm going to be sleeping on or what sort of things have occurred there in the past. But it's all fun and games. Anyway, because of that experience, you know, as I'm walking down the street wearing no clothes, with no wallet, no telephone, I realize that, you know, I could easily be confused for somebody who is a vagrant, a homeless vagrant, and picked up by the cops. And I didn't even have any identification on me or a phone or anything to call somebody in case that happened. But whatever. And so it occurred to me that this is one step along the way towards liberating myself to the maximum extent possible from this completely screwed up culture in which we're embedded.
Yeah.
And so a short time later, when somebody in Louisville called me and asked me to do a presentation there, Louisville, Kentucky, of course, I said yes, and they said, "Okay, well, we're car-free. Can we pick you up at the airport on a bicycle?" And at the time, I had ridden a bicycle 3 times in the last 35 years, and most recently about 6 or 8 years before that. So this couple picked me up at the airport, this young couple, and they had a bicycle trailer, so that allowed them to carry an extra bicycle for me. And so there we are in November in Louisville, Kentucky, in the rain at midnight, riding to their house, 5 miles. And the first time I've been on a bicycle for years, as I said. And so we rode back and forth to the venue over the course of the next couple of days. I'm soaking wet the whole time. I don't even know what I'm doing. I barely understand how a bicycle works. It was almost exactly a year later, my host in Chicago asked me if I want to ride a bicycle, because he rides a bicycle all the time. He's the registrar at the University of Illinois, Chicago, and he rides a bicycle to work, and he catches the train, blah, blah, blah. He has a nice fold-up bicycle. And so I said, yeah, sure, I'll ride a bicycle. And unlike the folks in Louisville who dressed me up in the dork suit, you know, the orange vest and flashlights and helmets and everything, over, I'm lit up like a Hollywood show.
Rob in Chicago
did not do that. Rob says, I don't wear all this stuff, so you can if you want. We have it all here. And I'm like, you know, when in Rome, when in Chicago, do it Chicagoan. So you don't wear all this stuff? Fine. I don't wear all this stuff either. He says, I think it just makes me more nimble. And if you have on a bicycle helmet, you're just a target for somebody in a car. Okay, fine. So we ride around the Sears Tower. We're in downtown Chicago riding on bicycles without any protective equipment. We're riding for about an hour or two. And I realized the fundamental error I had made when we stopped at a traffic light. He turns to me and he says, so, what do you think so far? And then I realized that this is incredibly dangerous and nobody in their right mind would be riding around with this traffic. We'd been almost hit 6 times at that point by cars that are always honking at us. And then I started really paying attention. I'm like, God, this is dangerous as hell. I can't believe I'm riding around with you, Rob, without any protective equipment. Get me out of here. But by that time, we're in downtown Chicago.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
And, like, he expected that. Like that's even more strange to me. Like, in his mind, that was perfectly fine. You know what I mean?
Oh, like, yeah.
That was perfectly fine. Oh, my. I'm still feeling guilty. I'm still feeling guilty about making you sleep down in my shamanic room with no heater or bathroom near or anything. Anyway.
Oh, hey, that's nothing compared to a no-clothes party and riding a bicycle in downtown Chicago without a helmet.
Catherine, that's got to be cool. So,
Then I started paying attention, and so I'd be driving by, and a car would just miss me, and somebody on the sidewalk would say, you see that guy? He's not wearing a helmet.
Oh, Jesus. Then you knew you were really screwed.
Right. From then on, I was terrified. Up till that point, I just thought, well, this is what everybody does. Why would I not do this? Wow.
Wow, you're gullible.
Oh, yeah. I fall for almost anything. Oh, you want me to sleep on this couch? This couch is a little crusty. Yeah, sure, I'll sleep on the couch. Whatever.
Oh, my God. That is hilarious. Oh, man, I'm seeing so many visuals in my mind. It's making me really laugh. Oh, God. So what else happened after that? Did you at least, did you reconcile your passive-aggressive anger after that with Chicago Man?
Well, no, I mean, I just continued to ride a bicycle for the next couple of days. I mean, in for a penny, in for a pound, right? Nobody killed me yet, so yeah. I'll just keep doing what I'm doing as if it's the right thing to do.
Well,
it was great fun. They have this incredible urban system there of bicycles that you can just check out for free or for almost free anytime, and they're incredibly durable, great bicycles, and they have lots and lots of places in town where you can hook them up and that sort of thing. It's a great system. I probably should have worn a helmet and a vest.
Yeah, that helmet. Well, that was, maybe he was testing you. Maybe he's like, oh, man, you're going to tell him I don't wear a helmet and see what he does. No, but that's awesome. But you know what's even more interesting is metaphorically these bicycle, you know, stories. It almost polishes off, or is the frosting on the cake for the beginning of our conversation, which is not taking a bicycle to get to the rally. You know, like let's beam you in, Scotty, to the rally, every rally that you can get to, because the bicycle is limiting. You know, oh man, that's right. Great. I love it.
Right. But, you know, it's also a great introduction to our conversation, because it really provides an example, a series of examples of trying to do something different, trying to be a human being that is not doing the same thing as every other human being stuck in this culture.
Yeah. And finding ways to challenge yourself, you know, exactly. When I was younger, my ADD, you know, how I used to get over that would be, not the ADD, the OCD. Of course, these are labels, but, you know, it's just, I'm very hyper. I've always been hyper. But when I would leave the house and I'd go, oh, man, did I shut off the stove? You know, and I'd go, oh, God, and I'm... Years of driving back and, oh, yeah, the stove's fine. You know, I think it was in the early 90s, I just said, I'm not going back. So I just stopped. I just stopped driving back to the house to see whether I had done whatever it is I was obsessing on. And right. I like to call that the moment I overrode, you know, all my own obstacles. And when you are of a strong mind, you know, it is easy to get these distractions and fall into these, you know, comfortable places that we insulate ourselves in that are safe and comfortable and, you know, sort of force people to bend the way that is more comfortable for us. And, you know, I'll bend a little bit this way for you. But, you know, for the most part, it's those random moments where you just shock the system, you know.
Ah! Yes.
My hands are dirty. Okay, I've got goats now and horses. Awesome. They stay dirty all the time. Yay.
Right.
You know, got over the dirty hands. But yeah, that's exactly it. You've spent this last year and a half for sure completely breaking all of your chains of oppression. And it's awesome. And I think what's even more awesome is watching it. You know, I am so proud of you. I know I'm annoying. I know I'm a tick that kind of burrows and, you know, but I serve a much bigger purpose that people don't usually get while they're being scrutinized by me. They get it later. And I used to like hate that and feel like take it personally and all that. But in terms of like, why do I have to be that way? Oh, you know, why can't I just be nice to everybody? Because you know when things aren't authentic and there's something about it that gets to you and you have to speak out, and that's a good thing. And you know, just as you experience, you know, trying to accept that, especially when you're coming from the academia where it's constantly the authoritarian system, you know. I mean, I was speaking out before anyone told me I couldn't speak out, and then it was always done jestfully, so I got away with everything, you know? And to try to become an adult and corral myself in was just not something that I was willing to do, because I think that I serve a purpose, regardless of how insane it seems to other people. So I appreciate that, you know, you've still loved me through all of my poking and jabbing. And we do. We love you so very much. You know, you're awesome, and to see you grow is exciting. See all of us grow.
Well, and you know, a year and a half later, I finally caught up to where you were, and I imagine that's very frustrating, because I bet that happens to you a lot. It takes people a long time to catch up to where you are. But, I mean, at least in my limited experience with you, you're a visionary. And so you saw where I was headed long before I figured it out. And now, finally, I'm catching up. So I appreciate what you've done for me and what you do for other people. You know, you're providing a service, and a lot of people don't like that.
Well, especially when I'm not usually asked to provide the service. I just do it anyway. No, I love people.
Well, right.
You know, I love people who I deem having, you know, what I saw in you is this is somebody that that has a powerful message. And I love you for that. And I love you for, stepping out in the ways that you do. The best thing I can do for you is not freaking book things. The best thing I can do for you, I mean, like, you know, little Gmail stuff. The best thing I can do for you, because I can't deal with Gmail, I'm sorry. Best thing I can do for you is again, just, you know, as I've done, and I do risk people not getting it and hating me, and that hurts me because I know they don't get it. But I do only mean the best for you, you know, always. I've always felt that way.
Well, of course, and I appreciate that. And there's an analog here, and the analog is me. When I'm delivering this message, I'm doing it from a position of care and compassion for the people I'm delivering to. Yeah. I'm not trying to be mean, right? I'm not swinging the cat by the tail.
No, absolutely.
And claiming that I'm doing some kind thing for the rats of the neighborhood.
It's very torturous. I watch you torture yourself all the time. Maybe others don't see it, but I can see it, you know. I can see what you go through. It's hard. And on top of it, the thing that I know others might not realize is that when you're liking everything, you do have an opinion. You do have things that you want to say beyond that. And it's the fact that you are a very compassionate person. See, I used to be that way. Now I just say it. I don't care. Because I think as an alchemist, I know we need to pour that peroxide in. You know, we need that radical healing. And I'm, whether I like it or not, a warrior. And you're a healer. You're a priest energy, you're a shaman, you know what I mean? It's just different processes. And the amount of stuff that I see you have to grit your teeth on, oh my God, I don't know how you do it. I'd be like sawing off my arm, you know? Oh yeah, uh-huh, cool. Sawing my arm off.
Right.
just to counterbalance. But I really am Kali Ma reincarnated. So there you go. If that makes sense, then there it is. That's my truth.
Hey, even if it doesn't make sense, there it is.
And there it is. Yeah. But
a whole lot of what we see around us doesn't make any sense.
No, I think that a year ago, the people that got so pissed off at us. Because I noticed you got that Scott Johnson dealio going, and I went at it with him more than a few times over on his stupid little site and his stupid little minions making fun of me because I'm not an academic. Well, hoo-hoo on you. But yeah, I've been really thinking about it in the last, you know, week about how many, not that we want to be right, my God, that's not what it's about, but you also don't want to feel that you're leading people down, you know, like, am I a horrible, horrible person that would say these negative things and hurt people this way? You know, I mean, is something wrong with me? You know? And right. So at least when we see that it's happening in a way that even a mole can see, you know, even the ostrich is going, what is that hail that's hitting my ass? You know, it's irrefutable at this point in time. And that's why it's exciting to see what direction we take the message in this new year, because it is now that we've got the attention, you know, where do we take that? And look at all the traps that are set up out there to fall into now. A whole new level of traps.
Right. Well, it is, the evidence is irrefutable, but there are still people, almost all of them heterosexual middle-aged white men at the apex of patriarchy, who will refute the evidence.
Oh yeah.
Even though it's irrefutable, who will kick back and fight and scream with reality.
Yeah, but they're gonna die.
Guess what? Well, you know, nature doesn't negotiate.
No, exactly. They're going to die. So it's the, ultimately, I think if there's one takeaway on them is that they're going to die. End of story.
Well, you know, it's sort of cruel to say it, but one of the very few advantages of near-term human extinction is the assholes die too.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. I mean, it's like, and the sad part is that, you know, they're going to be recycled back here again, and we're not. So good luck with that one.
I don't know
one.
If that's good news or bad news.
Well, I have a soft spot for humanity, so I like to come back and play this ridiculous game so that I can help people wake up, and each time I go, oh, wow, that was a cool experience. Not. I just hope that as a civilization we can finally understand our own human value and appreciate it beyond where we've found ourselves before. And I think that resonating with that thought is probably the most positive thing that we can do, is just believing that we're going to go down fighting, and not fighting out of fear, but fighting with, like, this is a party and I'm going to be the party spin master here. So, you know, right. Kick it, enjoy it, do it, you know.
Thanks so much for watching and supporting the voice of the independent community. Join us here next month at Gaia Rising Now for new episodes where we'll continue to highlight people in our community who wish to share their experience and what it's like to be human in the 21st century and all that's going on in our world and on our planet right now. Don't forget, we are the architects of a new reality. From the forest by the river, this is Wendy and the puppet poet and his puppet.